Hi, everybody. Dan Illman, Matt Byrne here. It's Derby Day, and race number 6 at Churchill Downs on Saturday is the Grade 1 Humana Distaff. Let's take a look at this field of filly and mare sprinters. And, Matt, I want to begin right down towards the inside with the number 1, the Keeneland grad, Finley's Lucky Charm. 6 for 6 lifetime at Churchill Downs, 10 for 15 lifetime. And she just beat 3 of these common foes most recently in the Grade 1 Madison at this distance at Keeneland. But I'm not so sure you like the blanket finish of the Madison, even though this horse did a lot of work on the lead.
Yeah, she did. You know, you look at Timeform US, they have that second quarter color-coded red, meaning the pace was hot. And you're right, she stuck around. I kind of look at that race and say, if you're going to take anyone out of it, it's probably her along with American Gal. And I look, I'm not thrilled about 5 horses across the wire, but it's hard to deny that she's 6 for 6 at Churchill. She's been in the exact 13 of 15 lifetime starts. The distance at 7/8 of a mile isn't a problem for her. I would imagine she moves forward second off the bench. I guess it depends. You need to make a decision. Do you like the Madison as a whole, or do you want to take a fresh face coming in?
She was pressing American Gal from the outside in the Madison. She draws the rail in the Distaff. Let's see what the Timeform US pace projector has in store for this race. They've got the number 8 American Gal out there on the lead. Do you think that Brian Hernandez Jr.'s hand is forced, however, by this rail draw? We know Finley's Lucky Charm has the speed to lead.
I think the good thing for BJ Hernandez is drawn to his immediate outside. I don't think there's any real burners. So I think he's going to be able to just kind of get out there. And if American Gal is hellbent on the lead with Jose up, then I think they're going to be content just taking that sort of stalking position just off. But at the same time, if I've got the rail, and we'll wait and see how things shake down. I mean, the rail is the shortest way around the racetrack. If I break alertly and just go, let American Gal be the one to make a decision. You either go or you sit. I beat her last time. Let her be the one to make the decision this time.
Let's talk a little bit about American Gal, who was so impressive last year for Simon Callahan, reeling off big wins in the victory ride, and then in the prestigious test, the signature race for 3-year-old fillies all year long. After the test, unfortunately, American Gal had some physical problems. She came back in the Madison in a race that Simon Callahan said he was using as a prep for this race. She did a lot of work on the lead. She battled gamely in the stretch. She was only beaten a neck. If you think she moves forward in her second start of the form cycle and she sits the outside stalking trip over Finley's Lucky Charm, there's no reason to think she can't turn the table. She gets a 5-pound weight shift as well.
Yeah, agreed. You know, I picked her in the Madison even knowing that little piece about that probably being nothing more than a means to an end. I think this outside draw, this is 2 times in a row she's drawn toward the outside. I think this is going to be very, very beneficial for her. I think she's a very talented filly. I have no reason to think that she won't be ready to go and a little bit tighter this time around. And if you believe the pace projector, she could work out. If she doesn't clear off to the lead, she's going to be sitting just off of it in second. I think in many ways you can make the case that she's the horse to beat, even though she finished behind Finley's Lucky Charm.
The beaten favorite in the Madison, the number 5, Lewis Bay, is back to try again. Now, Lewis Bay has run well in both starts in 2018. She just hasn't gotten to the winner's circle just yet. She's been a solid horse throughout her career for Chad Brown, but I was a little disappointed that she couldn't take better advantage of that fast pace up front.
I agree. I mean, you kind of look at it. She, on paper, had everything work out the way that she needed it to, and she just wasn't quite good enough. I've always been a little bit dubious of her, but at the same time, it's hard to argue with her consistency. She just shows up and runs very similar to Finley's Lucky Charm. But again, to me, this race comes down to, do you like the Madison or do you not? And if you don't, you need to look elsewhere.
Salty was only beaten 3/4 of a length in the Madison. She is cross-entered against Abel Tasman on Friday in the lot. Troyanne Marcassi has yet to make a decision. If Salty starts here, I think we have a similar situation with Lewis Bay, where I was a little disappointed she couldn't take advantage of the advantageous pace scenario. She worked out a good inside-out trip under Tyler. It took her a long time to change leads in the stretch. She was grinding it out. Maybe she is actually better at a longer distance.
Yeah, it's entirely possible. I've always thought that one turn is really kind of her game. But in going back to that Madison, we brought up that pace situation. If she couldn't get it done with an advantageous pace situation at 7/8, when you have a situation that looks like it's going to be like this on paper on Saturday afternoon, she's going to be up against it from a pace situation. I can't imagine her turning the tables.
And if the pace isn't fast, the break is the key. The break's always the key for the 3, Ivy Bell, now trained by Todd Pletcher. She is not a good gate horse. She won the inside information first time for Todd last time out. She bobbled coming out of the gate, but it wasn't her usual 2 slow, 3 slow, all kinds of problems. Now, she was just better than those horses. She overcame a little bit of a trouble, a little bit of blind switch at the top of the stretch. These are much better, but I like Ivy Bell at 7. And if there is some unexpected hitting up front, she could be running late at a decent price.
I've always been a big fan of this mare. I think there's a lot here, and now that she goes over to Todd's Barn, I think that's another positive. I think the race and the inside information, albeit against weaker company, I think it's better than it may look on paper, and I really feel if there's a scenario where she kind of slips through the cracks from a wagering standpoint, she could work out a decent trip in here, possibly in behind those two speeds that we spoke of. You know she runs well at Churchill Downs. You know 7/8 isn't a problem. This could be one of those rare instances where Todd and Javier, you get a decent price.
I know the Tarrant is graded stakes placed around two turns, but I think Ron Moquette has found her comfort zone as a 7-furlong horse. And who knows what could have happened last time out in the Grade 3 Distaff, because she got in trouble at a crucial moment in mid-stretch.
Yeah, she was impeded pretty badly, deep stretch. I think she probably would have gotten closer. I don't know if she actually would have won, but it would have clearly would have been better than what that length and a quarter defeat was, finishing fourth. The problem I have with her, I've always liked her as well. I think there's some ability, but when you just look at her overall body of this is what she wants to do, she's considerably the main contenders in here, and I just kind of think a minor award is her ceiling.
Miner's Cat's going to be up against it, perhaps from a class standpoint, beaten last time out in a 3X at Keeneland. She did finish ahead of a horse that came back to win at that level at Churchill Downs, but only with an 87 buyer.
Yeah, I thought it was a good run coming from off of it, but at the same time, what I just spoke about with Torrent as far as overall body of work, this filly, Miner's Cat, is slow as well.
Let's take a look at our top selections for the Grade 1 Humana Distaff. In from Southern California is your top selection, the number 4, Sky Diamonds, 4th in last year's Breeders' Cup Filly and Mare Sprint. When she's right, she's one of the better Filly and Mare sprinters in the country, and she kind of had no chance last time out in the Santa Monica the way that pace played out, right, Matt?
They just walked out there. You saw Selcourt break alertly. Paradise Woods, for some reason, was intent coming from off of it. And you find out that Paradise Woods had a sore foot coming out of that race. Neither here nor there. She never looked good at any point, Sky Diamonds. Now, she may not have had the race in her favor, but she was hard ridden for about a half mile, and she just kind of stayed on. The race was too bad to believe. I know what Sky Diamonds is. I think she's in that. We've seen so many times in the past the West Coast dirt horses are better than the East Coast dirt horses. Said it a few times already. I feel like if you like the Madison, you're going to take either American Gal or Finley's Lucky Charm or one of those horses. If you're a little bit skeptical of the race as a whole, like I am, I want a fresh face, and I have probably the most faith in Sky Diamonds to run one of her better races.
And she might be able to get a nice trip sitting in third behind the two speeds. 5-1 on the morning line for Sky Diamonds. You get Mike Smith for Bill Spar. I'll go with American Gal. I believe that she'll improve in her second start off the layoff. I really was impressed with what I saw from her last year as a 3-year-old filly, especially in the test at this distance. And with her on the lead or sitting second, I think she's going to be in prime position when the field turns into the stretch. 8-1-5-4 for me in the Grade 1 Humana Distaff. Race number 6 at Churchill Downs on Saturday has an approximate post time of 1:13 Eastern. Good luck.